The following program contains graphic material, including offensive language. Viewer discretion is advised.
She's got the news. She talks with newsmakers. She encourages us to laugh, and she cries with us. Speaking truth to power and questioning authority daily, it's the Nicole Sandler Show.
All right, and it is a Thursday. The days just keep ticking by. There's 50-some-odd days left until Election Day, but actually, only a couple of weeks until the first ballots go out. So if you're one of those vote-by-mail people, or maybe I should rephrase it, early voting drop off your ballot at the Supervisor of Elections office kind of person, because right now I don't know that any of us should be using the mail to get our ballots in unless you have no other choice, unless that's your only way to get the ballot to the Supervisor of Elections. But there are other options. So, you know, do what you can. If you do have to mail it, the minute you get that ballot, fill it out, put it in the envelope, stamp it if you need to, and send it back. Otherwise, do like we do and drop it off in person. And that way you can actually track your ballot by going to your county Supervisor of Elections office. You can look up to see if they've received your ballot yet and if it has been counted. So I encourage you to take control of your vote. Make your plan, as everyone's telling you, because it has never been more important than it is today. Because, frankly, we have a madman in the White House. So, you know, everything has gone kind of off the rails in the last few days since the story broke about Bob Woodward's forthcoming book, Rage, that will be out on Tuesday. But with each day, we're getting more little snippets of what is in the book. And it's not looking too good for Donald Trump, who has been lashing out on the Twitters. And I guess in person, too. So he's gone before the cameras a few times. And of course, last night, he called into Sean Hannity, because what else is he going to do? And I learned something new about Trump. He not only did that, but he held what, again, was billed as a press conference today. These, make no mistake, these are not press conferences. When he gets up in the White House briefing room, they are his, I got to come up with a catchy name for it. If you have a suggestion for a catchy name for what to call him, I mean, they were, when Sarah Huckabee Sanders was there, I think Laffy coined the phrase the Huckabee S session. What these are is Donald Trump wielding his presidential power to commandeer television time as often as he can. And today, oh my God, he got up there and he started in with, oh, look who's here. It's all the big guns are out. And he started naming off the different network correspondents who were there. Philip Rucker from the Washington Post and Caitlin Collins from CNN and whatever other names he rattled off. Like, you know, well, what did you think, you moron? You're under the spotlight right now because you stupidly gave 18 recorded interviews to Bob Woodward, who has, you know, taken down an administration or two. But reports say, again, I said that he's a star fucker, right? Well, overnight, I was reading all these reports that he was so impressed by Bob Woodward, and he was really kind of kicking himself that he never gave Woodward an interview before the first book came out, which I believe was called Fear, the first book about his administration, obviously. And so this time, Trump decided that he would do it, I guess, at the urging of Lindsey Graham. And then you had Fucker Tarleton last night blaming Lindsey Graham because he had to blame somebody for it. I don't often listen to Tucker Carlson. In fact, I don't think I've ever watched his show. But he, if you're wondering, how does one blame Lindsey Graham for Donald Trump giving 18 recorded interviews to Bob Woodward? This is how you do it.
That for repeated interviews with Bob Woodward. Why in the world would he do that?
Yeah, why?
Well, tonight, from a source who knows the answer to that mystery.
Yeah?
Senator Lindsey Graham of South Carolina.
Lindsey.
It was Lindsey Graham who helped convince Donald Trump to talk to Bob Woodward. Lindsey Graham brokered that meeting. Lindsey Graham even sat in on the first interview between Bob Woodward and the president.
Really? No.
How'd that turn out? Now, remember, Lindsey Graham is supposed to be a Republican, so why would he do something like
supposed
that?
Supposed to be.
You have to ask him. But keep in mind that Lindsey Graham has opposed, passionately opposed, virtually every major policy initiative that Donald Trump articulated when he first ran, from ending illegal immigration to pulling back from pointless wars to maintaining law and order at home. Lindsey Graham was against all of that more than many Democrats. So maybe you already know the answer.
Oh, maybe you already know the answer. So he's throwing Lindsey under the bus because I guess he can. Lindsey Graham. Unbelievable. So, I just somehow cut off our Twitch stream. God, you can't take me anywhere. Twitchers, I'm sorry. I'm going to try to get us going again. I got to figure out how to start it again. Oh, we're still on. Okay, cool. I guess it's still going. I just closed the window. Mistakenly. Sorry, chatters. I'm still here. Okay. So we're on Twitch, we're on Periscope, we're on Facebook Live. We're still not on YouTube, working on it. So it goes. All right. So back to Fucker Charlson blaming Lindsey Graham. You think it's because they're seeing the polling out of South Carolina and it's not looking so good for Lindsey and they think, well, he can be collateral damage. I don't know. I'm just asking. So Trump announces that he's going to do another press conference this afternoon at 3 Eastern. And again, I want another name for it. The hour of commandeered television time. It just doesn't have that sexy ring to it, you know? So feel free to call in if you have an idea for what we should call these bullshit sessions. That's one name. 954-889-6410 is the number. Or you can Skype to Nicole Sandler. Anyway, so I decided he was supposed to go on at 3. I think he started closer to 3:30. And I thought, all right, well, let me hear what he has to say. Because if ever he's under fire, well, now's the time. Because, you know, you got some splaining to do there, Donald. And so when he came out, he started reading in his monotone delivery, like, this is the first time I've read this third grade book report that somebody else wrote for me, and I'm just reading it now for the first time. Ooh, I'm reading it now for the first time. And it all just doesn't make sense, but I'm going to read the words anyway because that I've learned how to read word by word. That's how he delivers a speech. So he came out, and that's what he did. And then it was interesting. I was watching on MSNBC while I was in my studio getting everything set up for today's show. And I cut away for a minute because I had to do something else. And I came back and I saw that they had left the Donald Trump, whatever you want to call it, clusterfuck loser. And Ayman Mohyeldin, who I really like, was on, and he was reading off a list of the lies that Donald Trump told in the first few minutes of his not a press conference. So I caught it in mid stride. So, but here's the little bit that I caught of Ayman Mohyeldin.
Social distance guidelines that were ultimately put in place. So that was already one falsehood that had been picked up. The president also saying that deaths are rapidly going down and not seeing cases of spikes. That again goes against what Anthony Fauci was saying earlier today. We played that clip earlier in the program saying he is still very much concerned about the spikes that we're seeing take place across the country, in particular, those that may be happening in a couple of weeks as a result of the Labor Day. The president directing some criticism and falsehoods against Joe Biden, saying that he relies on a teleprompter to take questions. There's no evidence of that. The president himself frequently uses teleprompters in a lot of the events that he speaks in. That is obviously very well known. He defended saying that he does not, or he would be criticized if he used the teleprompter. That is not the case. Joe Biden has not launched a public campaign against vaccinations. That is not true. The president saying that Joe Biden has launched a public campaign for that, and also saying that Joe Biden endangers the lives of other people. Again, another falsehood that came out of the president there speaking at the White House.
Or, you know, another way to put it, that was
bullshit.
It is. Everything he says is bullshit. So then they went back to him and he started taking questions. And of course, he was so impressed that the big name reporters were out for him. So first he calls on Jonathan Carl of ABC News. Jonathan Carl, who also happens to be the head of the White House Correspondents Association. I'm not necessarily the biggest John Carl fan, but frankly, he worded the question the way it should have been worded. For the first question out of the box, thank you, John Carl, for asking what should have been asked.
Why did you lie to the American people, and why should we trust what you have to say
That's
now?
That's a terrible question. And
no, that was a great question.
Didn't lie.
The phraseology was perfect.
We can't be panicked.
That's not what you said at all.
I knew that the tapes were, these were a series of phone calls that we had, mostly phone calls. And Bob Woodward is somebody that I respect.
You respect.
Hearing the name for many,
just
many years.
Just hearing his name.
Not knowing too much about his work, not caring about his work. But I thought it would be interesting to talk to him for a period of, you know, calls.
Because he knew his name. Not really familiar with his work. Check out All the President's Men. Now, Donald, I know you don't read, but they even made a movie out of it. You can watch a movie, right? Well, you told us you watch a lot of television. I'm not going to keep playing this because you know what he's going to say. It's the same bullshit over and over again. But he went ballistic on Jonathan Carl. Why would you ask me that question? I didn't lie. And his new, excuse is, I told everyone, because remember he said the part about I don't want to cause panic or something like that, right? So that's what he's glommed onto. And at the end of his answer, I'm skipping way ahead, the end of his answer to Jonathan Carl.
I mean, I'm going to jump up and down in the air. And
right here. Wait, let me back that up again. Here, from here.
Europe. There was no lie here.
There was no
lie?
What
we're doing is we're leading, and we're leading in a proper way. The statement was made. You have to remember, I put the ban on China.
No, you didn't.
So obviously, outwardly, I said, it's a very serious
problem. No, you
didn't. And it's always a serious problem.
Here we go.
That doesn't mean I'm going to jump up and down in the air and start saying, people are going to die, people are going to die. No.
Okay, so it's one or the other. Either you're completely calm, or you're jumping up and down in the air saying, people are going to die, people are going to die. And I bring that up because he said it again. So the next reporter he calls on is Philip Rooker from the Washington Post, who asked,
you knew this was a deadly virus, you knew it was airborne, you knew on February 7th, you told Bob Woodward how it transferred from person to person in the air,
yes,
how deadly it was. Why did you not come to the podium?
Why didn't you tell us all?
Bob Woodward thought that was bad because this is stuff that everyone knew. There's a report that I have here someplace where China said it was airborne earlier
okay.
than the statement.
We're talking about
people
you.
People knew it was airborne. This was nothing. This was no big. When I say it was airborne, everybody knew it was airborne.
No,
this
we
was
didn't. Because no you told us it wasn't.
Well, read the reports. China came out with a statement that it was an airborne disease. I heard it was an airborne disease. I assumed it early on. The fact is, there has to be a calmness. You don't want me jumping up and down screaming, there's
going
to be great death.
Jumping up and down.
What? Really causing some very, very serious problems for the country.
Okay, this revisionist history is just more
bullshit.
It's just plain
bullshit.
It's just the man fucking lies every time he opens his mouth. The more I watched this, the more frustrated I got. And frankly, I didn't watch it very long. And he didn't last much longer. Apparently, he only took three questions before he left because, oh my God, he didn't like the way they were asking the questions. But he did tell us, look, I pay close attention. I go very far and wide. I get all the information. Just to tell you how I get my information, he actually said this. Listen carefully. This is how he got, this is the media he's ingested in the last 24 hours or so. Again, this was just at 3:30, 4 o'clock this afternoon. And this is how he knows what's happening.
I watch some of the shows. I watch Liz McDonald. She's fantastic. I watched Fox Business.
Oh, Fox Business, okay.
I watched Lou Dobbs last
Fox
night.
Oh, Fox Business, okay.
Sean Hannity last
Fox,
night.
Fox, okay.
Tucker last night.
Fox,
Laura.
Okay.
Fox and Friends in the morning.
Fox
you watch
and
the
Friends.
Shows.
Laura, Fox.
You don't have to go too far into the details. They cover things that are, it's really an amazing thing. They got caught in the biggest political scandal okay. in the history of our country.
Oh, shut the fuck up. Okay, some woman on Fox Business, some other Blue Dobbs on Fox Business, then Tucker and Laura and Sean Hannity and Fox and Friends. Do we notice a trend here? Everything he watched was on Fox. And you know what Fox is best at?
Your original source for fake news. Fox News. We make shit up.
They have, always have, and still do. So he was touting that. He rattled off like 7 hours of television since yesterday afternoon to today. And that shows that you don't have to go very far to get the facts. No, to get the bullshit.
Bullshit.
It just... Oh, my God. And of course, he didn't even mention his friends at OAN. Oh, that's the other person he called on. Because after, I'm telling you, after Jonathan Carl and Philip Rucker, he needed a friendly question. So he calls on the OAN bimbo who asked, how far are you along in that Durham investigation? And how many people are going to go to jail or some such nonsense like that? It just... It's opposite world. Look, I get he's grasping at straws. He's in deep shit, as he should be, or he should be. But the fact that this is going on is just stunning, absolutely stunning. So he did. Yeah, he watched. He did a thing yesterday too, where I'm trying to think where it is. Do I even have it? Okay, yesterday he did sort of a press conference that wasn't really a press conference, and he was asked why he misled the public, and again, he said he didn't. Then he went on Sean Hannity's show last night. Oh, and did you hear what he said to Hannity? He said, after sitting for 18 taped interviews with Bob Woodward, what does Donald Trump say anytime there's something not complimentary of him? It's fake.
He does hit jobs with everybody. He even did it on Obama. But constant hit jobs on Bush. I guess they did three books. They were all terrible.
Yeah.
So I figured, let's just give it a little shot. I'll speak to him. It wasn't a big deal. I speak to him.
18 times!
I don't know if the book is good or bad. I have no idea. Probably, almost definitely won't read it because I don't have time to read it.
Almost definitely won't read it because you don't read.
I gave him a little bit of a shot. Sounds like it's not going to be good.
Okay, and with him, it's either good or bad. Everything is good or bad. There's no other adjectives in his vocabulary. It's good or it's bad. And he guesses now this is going to be bad. I'm just, how does this man still garner 30 to 40% of the vote? That's what I don't get. And I'll throw it out there. I know I could easily find a dump supporter if I go out on Facebook or something, but I want to know if there's anybody listening to this program that actually supports this man. You know, I got to tell you, I was looking over the schedule of the upcoming debates, and there's a problem with the vice presidential debate that we'll get to. I'll bring it up when Howie's here. But the second of the three presidential debates is slated to be held in Miami. It was supposed to be in Ann Arbor, Michigan, and Michigan said, nah, we're not doing any of these events here. We got a pandemic going on. So, of course, Miami opens its arms because, Florida. Anyway, so they're holding at the Adrian Arsht Center, which is a lovely concert hall downtown. And it's going to be moderated by the guy from C-SPAN. I don't know his name, but they're all nameless anyway, aren't they? And it's going to be a town hall format. And I thought, okay, that's interesting. Here's the duh part. The only people who will be in attendance asking the questions in this town hall setting, they say they'll be, Florida, South Florida area residents who are uncommitted. If by October 15th you are uncommitted, you don't know who you're going to vote for between Donald Trump and Joe Biden, then you have no business being in a position to ask either of them a question. I'm sorry. If you are uncommitted, if you're undecided as to who you're going to vote for between those two, then you have no business opening your mouth, because it means you're an uninformed dolt. But then again, we know you're probably going to vote for Donald Trump because he loves the poorly educated. There are just no words. What brain surgeon came up with this brilliance? October 15th, 3 weeks out from Election Day, you've got two candidates who couldn't be any further apart. Well, I guess they could be, but, you know, two distinct choices. And you're only going to let people who haven't decided yet ask the questions? Ay, what a shit show. We get everything we deserve. Or we deserve everything we get. I just don't get it. All right. How about we do something funny? So yesterday, I know what it was. Yesterday, Donald Trump, sorry, I keep mentioning him, but I can't help it because he's everywhere. Can we please get rid of him? But yesterday, he held another event at the White House, ostensibly to, well, you know, take a couple of questions from the press, but to roll out his list of 20 more names to add to his list of contenders to be named to the Supreme Court should he get that opportunity again. And they were all awful. But the icing on the cake was Ted Cruz, I kid you not, he floated Ted Cruz as a potential Supreme Court nominee. Josh Hawley, the new idiot in the Senate from Missouri, the one who defeated Claire McCaskill, really? And the third name he threw out there was Tom Cotton. Tom Cotton from Arkansas. Oh, yeah, he belongs on the Supreme Court, let me tell you. He tweeted out yesterday, it's time to rid ourselves of Roe v. Wade. And that's who Trump wants to put on the Supreme Court, really? By the way, Michael Cohen, who's, you know, news about his book fell off the top front pages because of Bob Woodward. Oh, well, them's the publishing games, I guess. But Michael Cohen said, Donald Trump is not pro-life. He is pro-choice. He always has been. And I give him credit because I think it was the Rachel Maddow interview I saw. Somebody asked him, well, do you recall, Trump ever paying for an abortion? And he said, no, I don't. And he could, if he was lying, if he was making shit up, he could have gone there. But he said, no, I wasn't involved in any of that. Anyway, back to the Tom Cotton. I was cruising the interwebs looking for something funny to play for you today. And actually, David, my husband, found this one. And it appears to be a video on, I think, on Facebook from Tom Cotton's wife. Let's hear what she has to say, shall we?
I am the wife of Senator Tom Cotton. Tom's journey to the Senate was not a normal one. Tom was born on May 13th, 1977, when a little girl left one of those toys that you watch grow in water in a bathtub for too long until Tom gained consciousness and developed a human-presenting body. And that's how he got here. So if you've ever wondered, hey, why is that man walking around like he's still getting used to his new skin? You know, it's because he is. He still is. I think that Tom's platform can be boiled down to one word, okay? And that word is fear. Tom is scared of women. He is scared of queer people. And he's scared of the song WAP. What does Tom love? Oh my gosh, what doesn't he love? He loves guns. He loves his children because they are boys. He loves history. He's a big history buff. Anytime from 100 BC powder to 1919. Basically, anytime before women can vote, Tom loves that. Tom thinks that all life is valuable. All babies deserve to live unless that baby is a Black Lives Matter supporting Medicare for All wanting Antifa head bitch ass baby. And that's up for Tom to decide. If Tom is appointed to the Supreme Court, he will make sure that Roe v. Wade is overturned. Tom doesn't believe women can be trusted to make decisions. As you know, the last time he trusted a woman to make a decision, he ended up in his human form, you know, bearing the weight of mortality. And so Tom will make sure that women can't make decisions for themselves anymore. We know there are exceptions to everything, okay? We're not crazy. And so if you do find yourself pregnant with Tom's love child, you can come to him and he will personally write you a doctor's note so that you can have the procedure done. I am Tom Cotton's wife, and I approve this message. I am the wife of Senator Tom Cotton.
Okay. Oh, I lost my, that's what I was doing. Right? No, the show. This.
The Nicole Sandler Show.
On the Progressive Voices Network.
Ah, but you know what? I never fired back to get Progressive Voices back out of the spot. So let's do this again.
The Nicole Sandler Show.
The Nicole Sandler Show.
On the Progressive Voices Network.
By the way, that woman who purports to be Tom Cotton's wife, her her Twitter or Facebook name is, where is it? I got to find it. Blair Erskine. E-R-S-K-I-N-E. Blair, E-R-S-K-I-N-E. And she deserves credit because that was great. I will post that on the blog at NicoleSandler.com/9-10-20. That's today's date. That's how I post the show every day along with, selected things from the show. All right. Let's see. I wasted all this time. We've got Howie Klein coming up in a couple of minutes. He was not with us last week because he had a doctor's appointment, but he's back today. Let me tell you, if there's there is some breaking news. The Senate today failed to move forward on a scaled down $500 billion Republican coronavirus relief bill. Originally, think back, in May, the House passed a $3.5 trillion HEROES Act that would adequately fund us during this pandemic. It would provide more targeted relief, like those $1,200 checks we got many, many months ago. It would at least give us a little more money. It would provide money to schools. It would provide money for testing. It would provide money for states and cities who are really hurting as their tax base has shrunk because people aren't working. Anyway, what happened is Mitch McConnell said, we're not going to take up that Democratic bill that's already passed the House and has been waiting for us for 3 months. Instead, we're going to put this skinny bill. They like this skinny bill, this pared down thing that's worth $500 billion. And basically what happened is it failed along party lines. 52 out of the 53 members of the Republican caucus voted against it. Voted for it. 52 out of the 53, only Rand Paul voted against it. He said he was against any more spending on federal stimulus measures. So there you go. And all the Democrats voted against it, saying it just didn't go far enough. And Bernie Sanders said, how pathetic. He actually tweeted this out. He said, while Senate Republicans tell us we can't afford to give $2,000 a month to the working class during the economic crisis, the COVID-19, quote, relief bill they just released provides $161 million in corporate welfare to the coal industry during a climate emergency. So that happened. All right. Quickly, we'll go to the phones before I get Howie on the line. Hi, who's this?
My name is Vivian Marlborough.
Vivian who?
My name is Vivian Marlborough.
Okay.
My mother is Spanish.
Oh, gotcha. Okay. Hi. That's all right.
All right. My name is Vivian Marlborough. Hold on. My mom is a big fan of you.
Okay.
I'm not.
Okay.
I'm conservative and not here to debate you.
Ah.
You have said, no, my mom's a big fan of you, but
gotcha.
I'm not. I'm
okay, your mom listens, but you're not. You're a right winger. Mom is sensible. So you're calling in to tell me why you support Donald Trump. Why do you support Donald Trump?
Donald Trump.
Okay.
I don't support Donald Trump. I'm voting for Joe Jorgensen. But the
for
way
who?
That you treat
Wait, you're voting for who? Who?
I'm voting for Joe Jorgensen.
Joe Jorgensen,
the Libertarian candidate.
Okay, go, boy, that vote's going to really count. Okay, good for you.
Wow.
Way to use
wow.
that vote.
Gee,
yeah.
Gee, how condescending. Yeah, I'm totally stupid, right?
Yeah.
Anyway,
yeah.
The point I'm trying to make is you paint all of us Republicans as stupid.
Yeah.
And that's just dumb. You paint us all as stupid.
I paint you as stupid, but that's dumb. Okay. I think it's stupid to support the policies of this fake president. I think it's criminal that anyone would support him right now. I think it's criminal that Republicans in Congress haven't stood up to this thief, this con man, this bastard. What do you think about your Republican representatives sticking up for this guy?
Well, that's their decision. They can stick up for what they want. They're individuals. That's the point.
But otherwise, they don't act as individuals. They follow. They do what Mitch McConnell tells them to do.
I don't let other people think for me.
What happened to Lindsey Graham? Lindsey Graham, who famously said he's a con man, he's a grifter, he's a thief, he's a crook. There's something really seriously wrong with him. What happened to him?
He had to support him because Trump was the one who was winning the primary. Just like how Bernie Sanders had to support Hillary Clinton in 2016.
All right. Thanks for your call. It's time for my guest. I got to run. Next time, call in earlier because I actually really would like to talk to you, but I have a guest coming up and who I've got to get to. But, thanks for your call, and thanks for throwing away your vote. Oh, way to go. All right. I know I asked for a Trump supporter, though. I don't want to argue with someone who knows Trump's evil, although I would have liked to hear why he thinks it's okay that not one member of the Republican caucus of the U.S. Senate will speak out against this man who is a grifter, a con man, a thief, a crook, who is robbing this nation blind, who lies every time he opens his mouth. And it's okay for every Republican senator, except maybe Mitt Romney, to have his back? I'm sorry, I think there's a problem there. So maybe tomorrow, our friend from the San Diego area, or someone else who can speak to this insanity, will call, because I'd really love to hear from you. But now, it's time to get Howie on the line.
Are you a multinational corporation hungry for a treat? Well, come on down to Schmucky Chucky's, where you'll personally be seated by Chuck Schumer himself.
So many dishes, and they're all fresh.
You're gonna love our Blue Dog special, the Dino Burger, because we say so.
A good hamburger and french fries.
And every burger comes with a side order of
grits. I love grits. I love anything with corn. It's corn.
All for only $50,000. Wash it all down with a Dirty Debbie.
9/10 water, 1/10 orange juice. After a week or two, you drink this, it's 200 calories and it's acetic.
And wipe your mouth with a tissue print of Glass-Steagall. For dessert, try our DNC tarts.
Little cookies, tell the quality of that.
Most restaurants give you a mint, but at Schmucky Chucky's, you get complimentary.
Sweet and low.
Who picks up the tab for all this? Find out now with Howie Klein of Down With...
Second, for some reason, I do not have audio on our shot here, so I got to bring that up before I can bring up your picture. But I've got you there. Howie, you with us?
I am.
I'm fixing the picture thing. For those who wonder why Howie is not on video with us, he just doesn't want to be, which is okay. I have no problem with that. I understand. But so we've got the picture of you at the podium at the People for the American Way. I don't know how many years ago that was taken, but it's a great shot.
Oh, that was a great night. And if it's the same one, I think, mm-hmm. Yeah, it was. It was a great night. And Green Day was there as well. They didn't play. Did they play? I don't think they, but I don't know.
Who was that?
I know what it was. They got an award that night for their, so it's not like a music award per se.
Right.
But it was because they were so strong in their anti-fascist message in their music.
Who? I'm sorry.
We decided to give them an award.
You cut out when you said the band. Who was it?
Green Day.
Oh, Green Day. Duh. Of course. Well, cool. Very nice. That's cool. Speaking of music, I saw that you tweeted it out as well. Bruce Springsteen to the rescue. He released the first single, I guess, from a new album that we didn't even know he was recording. Letter Home or My Letter Home or something like that.
Letter to You.
Letter to You. There you go. And
I saw it. I was hoping it was going
to
be
a letter to Trump
that he wrote at some point, that it would be. But it's not anything about that. It's not about Trump at all, as far as I can see.
Yeah.
And but it's a good song. That's why I tweeted it. Not political, just yep. Something worth
listening to on a musical level, and maybe a little beyond music, but not in a political way.
Right. And here, the thing about that is, I read about it. Apparently, the E Street Band is all on the record. They all went over to Bruce's house, where he's got a studio. They recorded it in 4 days live. No overdubs, no nothing. They just, this is like the first, this is a real live record that they recorded in just a few days. So it'll be out next month, and awesome. Because a Bruce Springsteen album is always good for my soul.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. So, and again, he does this. He did this after 9/11, which, by the way, is tomorrow. Tomorrow's the 19th anniversary of 9/11, which, wow. And after that record came out and the nation was hurting, so the story goes, someone was driving along, I think, near Asbury Park and saw Bruce and shouted out the window, "We need you." And Bruce went and wrote The Rising, which I think is still one of his best albums. So sometimes he does rise to the occasion, and I can't wait to hear the rest of this record. So there's our musical treat for today. As for the other kind of treat, oh my God. I've often said, Howie Klein, that there is no bottom with this guy, with Trump. You know, just when you think you've hit the basement, you realize, oh my God, there's like four sub-cellars. And when you get down to the bottom level, you realize it goes even further down. It's like a never-ending spiral. This Bob Woodward stuff, I mean, I haven't read the book, but just the tapes we've heard so far are pretty revelatory. You know, and poor Trump is spinning his wheels trying to gaslight his way out of it, and somehow I don't think he's going to.
No. Well, although for his fans it doesn't take much. I got a call earlier today from one of my old bosses, Russ Thyrat, who is the chairman of Warner Brothers.
Right.
When I worked for him, I was the president of Reprise, which is part of Warner Brothers. So, and we are still close friends. And he called me and he said something very similar to what you just said. There is no bottom, is what you said.
Mm-hmm.
What he said is that every day there's something worse than the day before.
Yeah.
And it just buries what was before. He had been really upset about this whole military thing,
right,
about how Trump had denigrated servicemen and women, and he thought, you know, that was going to be, you know, talked about from here to eternity.
As it should be, but yeah.
And then, boom, along comes this book, and it just buries it, just the way the military story pretty much buried Michael Cohen's book.
Right.
It's amazing.
Yes.
I mean, every day another thing comes up. You know, Russ is very concerned about the military. His mother particularly, I mean, his father was in the military too, but his mother was Dwight Eisenhower's top aide.
Oh, wow.
And when he was a general, so when he was fighting in Europe, his mother, you know, you always see him with a WAC, or I think it's called a WAC, right? A woman in the Air Force.
Uh-huh, woman, Army.
That's right, mother.
Yeah, I don't remember, but yes, I think that's it. How interesting. Yeah, I think the military, I thought that those statements, and again, this also came from Bob Woodward, that those statements were just, they might be the final nail in his coffin, or the straw that broke the camel's back, or whatever, you know, metaphor you want to make.
I mean, the stuff those generals all had to say about him was just like, you just jaw-dropping. I mean, have you ever imagined that the cabinet members and the highest people up in the military would say this about a sitting president? I mean, it's inconceivable.
No, but with this guy, I do expect some of them to come forward. And actually, you know, I don't ever agree with Donald Trump about anything, and I don't agree with what he said. You know, Bob Woodward, if it was bad, because he only knows two adjectives, good and bad, apparently, if it was a bad statement that I said when he admitted that it was a horrible, dangerous virus, worse than the flu, that first recording we heard, if Bob Woodward thought that was a bad statement, he would have immediately released it. He didn't think it was bad. The fact that he said it and then turned around and lied to the American people and said, "Nothing to see here, no big deal, it's going to go away," that's bad.
And I mean, it doesn't answer anything, and I don't know why anyone would think it would. I mean, Trump, I mean, aren't there people around Trump who are like, you know, telling him he's, you know, like maybe cut out the Adderall and get down to earth for a little while and stop with this craziness? I guess they don't. They just let him do whatever he wants, which is shocking.
But they didn't know. That's the thing. He doesn't take counsel well, apparently. You can't tell him what to do. And apparently his aides had no idea that he had done 18 interviews with Bob Woodward. Apparently they were trying to steer him away from doing these interviews. The first couple were done in person where there was an aide there, there was a stenographer, they were taking notes. But then apparently he started calling him late at night. He called him from out on the road. He would make just these phone calls to him without this press office or any of his White House aides knowing what he was doing. So a lot of this stuff, they have no idea what is coming in this book on Tuesday.
Yeah, although it's hard to imagine that there's going to be even more horrible, that there'll be stuff that's more horrible than what's already come out. I mean, the stuff that's come out, the tapes that we've listened to so far are just, like, absolutely shocking. I mean, really shocking. And it makes me think, like, there's still, I don't know, 38, 39, 40% of the people are either going to vote for him or are considering voting for him. Not of the people, but among voters. And how is it possible? How is it possible? And is this going to change it? Will it go to 35%?
Yeah.
Will it go to 33%? Will it go to 20%?
Yeah. I don't know. And that's the thing. As much as I really don't want to talk to a Trump supporter, I really want to talk to a Trump supporter to find out how they can support this guy. What is it that he's got over them to make them think that, yeah, this is a guy that I think should lead the nation? What? You know, you said, I don't know that anything worse can come out, but things keep coming out. So first we heard, you know, his demeaning of the military, right?
Yep.
Then it was obviously his downplaying of the risks, the dangers with the coronavirus. There's one more clip that has been released that hasn't gotten as much play, but it was when Woodward asked him about white privilege. You heard that? Have you heard this one?
No.
Oh, okay. Let me play this for you because this says so much. Here we go.
Hey, but let me ask you this. I mean, we share one thing in common. We're white, privileged. My father was a lawyer and a judge in Illinois, and we know what your dad did. And do you have any sense that privilege has isolated and put you in a cave to a certain extent, as it put me, and I think lots of white privileged people, in a cave, and that we have to work our way out of it to understand the anger and the pain, particularly black people, feel in this country.
You really drank the Kool-Aid, didn't you? Just listen to you. Wow. No, I don't feel that at all.
You really drank the Kool-Aid? Wow, listen to you? No, I don't feel that at all?
Yeah, well, he was being honest.
I guess. There's another part where apparently Trump called Woodward from Davos when he was over there for the World Economic Forum. So after attending it, I guess that night, there's Trump playing, you know, on the toilet, on the Twitter. He's like, oh, I should call my pal Bob Woodward. And apparently during the conversation, Woodward asked Trump about the Khashoggi murder, right?
Yep.
So let me just read to you. This was from an article, I think, in the Washington Post.
And this is outrageous.
This is outrageous. So Woodward told Trump on January 22nd, the people at the Post, Washington Post, are upset about the Khashoggi killing. That is one of the most gruesome things you yourself have said. Trump said back to him, quote, I saved his ass. I was able to get Congress to leave him alone. I was able to get them to stop. Then he said to Woodward, well, I understand what you're saying, and I've gotten involved very much. I know everything about the whole situation. The story goes on to say Trump added that Saudi Arabia spent billions of dollars on U.S. products. He also stressed MBS's claim that he's innocent, though U.S. intelligence and other foreign intelligence agencies have concluded otherwise. Quote, Trump, he will always say that he didn't do it. He says that to everybody, and frankly, I'm happy that he says that. But he will say that to you. He will say it to Congress. He will say that to everyone. He's never said he did it. Woodward asked, do you believe that he did? And Trump says, no. He says that he didn't do it. And then Woodward again says, I know, but do you really believe? And then Trump cut him off and says, he said very strongly that he didn't do it. Bob, they spent $400 billion over a fairly short period of time. And you know, they're in the Middle East. You know, they're big because of their religious monuments. You know, they have the real power. They have the oil, but they also have the great monuments for religion. You know that, right? For that religion. They wouldn't last a week if we're not there, and they know it. What? Oh, my. He's just delusional.
Yeah, or his mind just works in such a sort of a sick way. It's just amazing how he jumps from one thing to another, and it just really tells you a lot about who he is and what he is.
It is insane. And then yesterday... He decides he wants to try to change the subject, so he calls this event at the White House to announce the names of 20 people that he'll consider, that he will nominate should he get the chance to, you know, appoint someone else to the Supreme Court. And among some really horrible choices, a few who have gotten a not qualified assessment from the American Bar Association, he throws out the names of Ted Cruz, Josh Hawley, and Tom Cotton.
Cotton immediately started drooling, and although he wants to be president, he started drooling and saying, yes, it's time to end Roe v. Wade.
Oh my God. It is just first astounding. It is astounding. I'll have to send this video to you because I played it earlier in the program, but it's a woman who purports to be Mrs. Tom Cotton. Sings his praises.
They got him to marry his secretary. Like, one of the women who worked in the secretarial pool, once it started coming out that he was a closet case, immediately got one of his employees to agree to marry him. So,
oh, that's
yes, there
fun.
Is
Ooh.
Theoretically Mrs. Tom Cotton.
But this can't be her, because this was very funny. I'll send it to you. I've already played it, or I'd play it again. Maybe I should play it again anyway. Tom Cotton. Oh, my God. It seems like the closer we get to November 3rd, the more his head is about to explode. And there's certainly no shortage of things to talk about. I ran across this morning. I was looking at the debate schedule, and they have three presidential debates set and one vice presidential debate. I don't know if you heard what I said. The second presidential debate, which is happening on October 15th, is going to be down here in Miami at the Arsht Center. Did you hear the format of this one?
No.
It's a town hall moderated by a guy from C-SPAN. But here's the rub. All of the questioners will be people from, I guess, South Florida who are still undecided. If October 15th, they're only going to allow people who haven't yet decided, excuse me, between Donald Trump and Joe Biden to ask questions, because they've got to be the most informed people out there, right?
It's odd. It's especially odd because most people plan to vote before then.
Yep. Yes, they do. And yes, they are having the debates late. But really, so I live in South Florida. I'm an informed constituent citizen, and I can't ask a question because I am not undecided between Joe Biden and Donald Trump. It just is asinine to me.
There's not very many people left who are undecided. If I remember, when I'm looking at the polls generally, it's like, 2 or 3% only.
Right. And I'm sorry, they can't be the brightest bulbs in the chandelier if they don't know between Donald Trump and Joe Biden who they're going to vote for. you know?
Yeah.
I mean, it's not like...
I guess they're Republicans who are just, you know, not sold on Trump or thinking that... I don't know what they're thinking. I mean, it really takes, like you said, it's a dull bulb.
Yes, right? And then I read this morning, the moderator of the vice presidential debate, which is happening somewhere in here. Oh, it's on October 7th in Salt Lake City, is Susan Page from USA Today. And I thought, all right, well, whatever. Well, then I read this. Susan Page, who reportedly threw a girls' night in Seema Verma's honor at her house, funded by taxpayer money. Seema Verma is Trump's director of Medicare and Medicaid services. This is a Trump partisan, and Susan Page threw her a girls' night get-together at her house, funded by us. That doesn't sound like somebody who's an objective questioner in this matter. I want them to bring back the League of Women Voters to oversee these debates. Not that it matters what
I... Who is overseeing them? They wound up in like four cities that are all like, you know, pretty Republican places.
Yeah, well, there is a commission on... I'm trying to look it up now. I think it's Commission on Presidential Debates.
There is a commission, that's right.
Right. And frankly, the one that is happening in Miami was supposed to be in Ann Arbor, Michigan. But the governor of Michigan said we're not having any big events here. We're not doing it here because of the pandemic. So
wait a minute. You're not saying it's going to be a live event, are you? It's going to be like... people near
well,
each other?
It's a town hall, so there have to be people there unless they're going to Zoom them in.
I would think.
Yeah, I would think. I mean, it's at a beautiful theater. The Adrian Arch Center is beautiful, but that's what it's going to be, October 15th. The vice presidential debate, University of Utah in Salt Lake City, and I hope they're doing them without audiences. First of all, they shouldn't have an audience.
The interesting thing is that I know, you know, Biden is very, very careful about that. His events are all, you know, socially distanced and very, very, very strictly so.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas Trump's events are a joke. I mean, people don't wear masks. They're all over each other. And it's crowded. Everyone is like spitting. It's like every event that he does is a super spreader event. It's amazing. I mean, people don't understand how bad for the country these kind of events are. I mean, they really do kill people. You probably read this. You probably talked about it already on your show. But that motorcycle rally in Sturgis, South Dakota, turned out to cause, not always directly, sometimes indirectly, but it caused 260,000 new cases in the United States. I mean, the U.S. has 2.5 million cases right now and rapidly rising. Did I say 2.5? I meant 6.5, sorry.
Yes.
6.5 million cases. And here we have 260,000 caused by a 10-day motorcycle rally in a small town in South Dakota. And it wasn't just people who attended the rally. Then, you know, they went home to Colorado and Arizona and Minnesota, and they brought it with them and spread it. So this German think tank did a very, very careful academic study, and, you know, just tracing everybody and everything, and it was just amazing. And they attribute $12.2 billion in medical costs and 260,000 new cases.
That's right. And I read that if they had paid each of the participants not to go, they each would to equal that $12 billion or whatever the price tag is going to be for the treatment of all those people who got sick, they each would have walked away with about $25,000.
Yeah, 27. But yes, and the 25, I'm sorry, the price tag is only if no one dies. So when they figured out how much it's going to cost, the $12.2 billion, that was premised on no one dying. Well, people already have died.
Yeah, right. Yep, I hear you. I get it. it's just frightening. But there's more. I mean, we could keep going. Bill Barr taking over as Trump's lawyer, having the Justice Department step in to represent him against the libel suit filed by E. Jean Carroll, who accused him of rape. This is insane. Everything about it. Then there's a new whistleblower from the Department of Homeland Security who said not only were they told to modify intelligence assessments to suit Donald Trump's agenda, but you know they're also told that you can't talk about white supremacy as being a threat, which this report had noted was the chief threat to in domestic issues was white supremacy, but they wanted it to point the finger at Antifa and other, quote, leftist groups. All this stuff is going on at the same time.
Right. So something like this whistleblower gets lost in the shuffle. I mean, it's something that would normally, you would think this would be like the biggest story in a year. This isn't, it doesn't even make it into the news cycle.
Right, because there's so much shit that they can't possibly get to all of it. And that's the problem where, you know, a newscaster has to pick and choose. Well, do I cover the perversion of the Justice Department to be Donald Trump's personal lawyer in a rape accusation, even though that's not what the case is? It's a libel accusation, but still has nothing to do with the presidency, has nothing to do with us. Or do we cover the fact that he, you know, calls military people losers and suckers? I mean, where do you go?
Everyone knows that Trump is not good for his word, and you know he's an inveterate liar. He has no sense of loyalty to the people who work for him. But do you think people like Barr, who is not a fool? And people like what's his name, the Postmaster General,
DeJoy,
also you know not an idiot.
God.
Do you think these people have gotten pardons in advance, blanket pardons from Trump to do all this kind of illegal stuff that they're doing? I mean, would they do it without that? I mean, you know, people are howling for Barr's head.
As they should. I've never seen anything like this, and I don't know. I honestly don't know. This man, he was an attorney general before. That's why, you know, Democrats in the Senate thought, okay, well, he can't be that horrible. I don't know what happens to these people once they get under his spell. I don't know if it is the effect of being in a cult. I don't know if Donald Trump has pictures of them like he must have for Lindsey Graham. I don't know. It just doesn't make any sense.
Yeah. Horrifying, just absolutely horrifying. And I mean, do you think that people want to see Barr in prison, for example?
Yes, he certainly deserves to be. I'm trying to think back. What was his name? John Mitchell from the Watergate days. Now I was young then. I don't remember exactly what John Mitchell did, but he went to jail. That's where Bill Barr deserved
to be.
He was the attorney general, right, during Watergate. I don't know what the infraction was exactly that imprisoned him.
Not as bad as what Barr is doing.
Exactly. It can't be. I even heard Carl Bernstein in an interview said, these tapes that Woodward has, worse than anything we got, any of the Nixon tapes, much more incriminating, much more, you know, worse for the president, and yet he's like Teflon. It just all rolls off of him.
Well, he's like Teflon, not to the general population, not to the media. He's like Teflon to his
40%
base of orders. Right. That is the part that I can't understand. And I even, you know, I mean, not that I speak with him, but I have a brother-in-law who's one of these people.
What do you mean, one of these people?
He is a Trump supporter who's never going to be shaken.
Wow. I don't get it. And that's why I keep asking someone to call in, because I really want to know, what do they respect about him? What could they possibly look up to in him?
What could they possibly say to you? What could they say to you that would be of any interest? I mean, if they're all like my brother-in-law and they call in, what you're going to get
is a repetition, regurgitation of the Rush Limbaugh show. That's it.
Yeah, well, that's when I hang up.
Nothing but that.
I just don't get it. It makes no sense. It's opposite world, as I constantly refer to it. November 3rd can't come quickly enough, although I can't say I'm actually looking forward to what happens between November 4th and January 20th. I think no matter how we look at it, we're screwed. Howie Klein, here we are. Thank you. We're out of time. I will talk to you next week.
Thank you.
Thanks, Howie. Bye-bye. And I'll see you tomorrow. Thanks for listening, everyone. Bye.